Okay, can we get started? All right, if we can get started. So what we're going to talk about today is this innate or non-specific immune system. And we're going to primarily be concerned with talking about the cellular components of the non-specific immune system and what they do. We'll talk about the humoral components. In fact, the one major humoral component, which is complement, in the next hour. Okay, again, so here's we've seen this one before, how we break the immune system down. We'll be talking about mainly the cellular components here, and then in the next hour talk about those humoral components. Okay, before we get to the actual cells, though, there are actually other parts, components of the non-specific immune system, things that are considered components of the non-specific immune system. Some of them are just anatomical barriers. There can be mechanical factors, chemical factors, biological factors. Then we have those humoral components. This is the one that we'll talk about in the next hour mostly, because this is probably the most important of the humoral components of the non-specific immune system. And then we have these cellular components, the neutrophils, the monocytes, the macrophages, NK cells, which we will explain what they are, and eosinophils. Okay, so let's first of all look at these anatomical barriers. The skin itself is part of this innate immune system because the skin acts as a physical barrier. We're covered with bacteria, but those bacteria don't get penetrate through the skin. They'll stay on the skin surfaces, all right? So that acts as part of this anatomical barrier. And the mucous membranes also are effective barriers to pathogens getting into the body. In the skin, the desquamation of the skin helps constantly remove any bacteria that are adhering to the skin. So these are all considered as part of the non-specific or innate immune system. The ciliated epithelium in the respiratory tract, this mucociliary elevator, helps get rid of any bacteria that we inhale. We're going to cough that up, and it'll be removed. Okay. In the epithelium, the flushing action of the tears in saliva. In the urine, these help keep these body cavities clean. Okay, so that's all considered as part of these anatomical barriers of this system. In addition to that, there are some chemical barriers at these sites. In the skin, the sweat, there are fatty acids in the skin that are antimicrobial. And so they're considered part of this non-specific or innate immune system. They're ready to go, and that's why they're primarily going to be constitutive components. In the mucous membranes, in the stomach, the HCl, the high acidity of the stomach actually is a barrier because most bacteria, as you're going to find out, have a certain pH that they live in and they can survive in. And most of them cannot survive in that environment. So that in itself kills them. In the tears and saliva, we have things like lysozyme. This is an enzyme that breaks down bacterial cell walls. When Dr. Fox comes in the bacteriology section, he'll talk to you about the cell wall of bacteria. This is an enzyme that breaks that cell wall down, and that cell wall is required for that bacterium to survive in order to resist the high osmotic pressure. Phospholipases are also found in the tears and saliva, which break down membranes. There are proteins called defenses. These are small proteins in the respiratory tract that are antimicrobial. They kill bacteria. All of these are considered part of this system. Surfactants in the lung act as an opsonin. An opsonin is a substance which, when it binds to a particle, makes that particle more easily phagocytosed. All right? So it's something that makes it more palatable for the phagocytic cells. And so a surfactant is one of these opsonins. And then, of course, there are also biological factors at these anatomical sites, and in primarily what we refer to as the normal flora. The normal flora is very important in protecting us from infections with pathogens. As I said, we're covered with bacteria, and which is considered part of our normal flora. And pathogens have to compete with that normal flora. They have to compete for nutrients. And they have to complete for binding. Most pathogens are going to have to bind to something in order before they're going to start causing disease. So the normal flora is very important in this regard. In addition, the normal flora can actually produce substances that kill other bacteria. Bacteria have this ability to make what are called colocins, and colocins kill other bacteria. So they will secrete these colocins and destroy pathogens. And then we have the humoral components. And again, we'll just very briefly go over this because we're going to talk about complement a lot in the next hour. Complement, as we're going to see, it can lead to the lysis of the bacteria and also some viruses. Certain components of complement will act as an opsonin, right? And the complement components can increase vascular permeability and recruitment of and activation of these phagocytic cells that we're going to talk about shortly. But its complement is not the only humoral component. There are components of the coagulation system that do similar things, increase vascular permeability, recruit the phagocytic cells. And then in addition, there are also some antimicrobial substances like beta-lysin from the platelets is actually a cationic detergent and will destroy bacteria. Things like lactoferrin and transferrin, these are iron-binding proteins. And iron is a very important nutrient for bacteria. And since iron is fairly insoluble, there's not a lot of iron available. And so when we have these things like lactoferrin and transferrin that bind up the iron, it makes it unavailable for the bacteria, which is needed for growth. Lysozyme is also found in a lot of secretion. They break down bacterial walls. And then there's a series of cytokines that we'll talk about that can have a lot of different effects, and we'll talk about each of them as they go along. Okay, but what we want to concentrate on are the cellular components, the neutrophils. Primary job, of course, is phagocytosis and killing any bacteria that it phagocytoses, that it eats, okay? But neutrophils also play a role, obviously. They contribute to the inflammatory reactions and the tissue damage. We're going to see that the products that they produce can actually cause tissue damage. Macrophages are the other phagocytic cell. And again, they not only phagocytose, but they kill the bacteria that they eat. Now, macrophages also have some other properties. They're also, that the neutrophils don't have, they're actually able to kill other cells that are infected. So this is referred to as the extracellular killing of another cell. So the macrophage kills some other cell. Macrophages also are involved in tissue repair. And if you remember from yesterday, I mentioned that there's this interaction between the specific and non-specific systems. Macrophages are one of these cells that participate in that interchange because they actually present antigen to the specific and help develop a specific immune response. So they're going to be involved both in the innate immune system, but they're also going to be involved in the specific immune system. NK cells. NK stands for natural killer cells. These are cells that have the ability to kill virus-infected cells or also cells that are altered self-targets, so transformed cells, malignant cells. These NK cells can kill that. Now, the LAK cells, LAK cells, these are actually derived from the NK. They're just activated NK cells. So if you activate these NK cells, and we'll discuss shortly how you activate them, then they convert into what is referred to as a LAK cell. And LAK stands for lymphokine activated killer, is all it stands for. And then we have the eosinophils. Eosinophils are particularly effective in killing certain parasites. The granules in the eosinophil are very toxic to certain parasites, primarily the worm parasites. And so they're important in defenses against those. All right, so let's look at this process of phagocytosis and intracellular killing. First of all, here's the cells. Of course, the PMNs, you know, have this characteristic nucleus, and of course can be recognized morphologically. They have a number of different granules that we'll talk about shortly. And there are a series of antigens on the surface of various cells that are used to identify those cells. And in the case of the neutrophils, that antigen is CD56. These antigens you're going to see have these CD markers, and there's several hundred of these CD markers. We'll be concentrating on a few of them, and one of them is the CD66, which is a marker for neutrophils. Now, these PMNs, of course, can be identified morphologically, so it's fairly easy to do it morphologically, but this is an alternate way of measuring them, by looking for this antigen. And of course, we have antibodies against all of these CD antigens that are used then to detect the antigen present on that cell. All right, the granules that these cells have, there are two types of granules. One are called the primary granules. These are also referred to as the azurophilic granules. Is an alternate name, primary or azurophilic, because they stain, their characteristic stain, the blue stain that they have when you stain them. These are characteristic of younger neutrophils, that they have this. And the components that they contain things like cationic proteins, which are going to be antibacterial. They contain lysozyme, which can break down bacterial cell walls. They contain these defenses, elastase. And what is characteristic of these azurophilic granules, or primary granules, is this enzyme myeloperoxidase. And we'll see what role it plays. The other type of granules they have are the secondary granules. These are sometimes also referred to as the specific granules. So these are the secondary or specific granules. And these are characteristic of more mature neutrophils. And the things that they contain, again, lysozyme, they contain a component of this enzyme, NADPH oxidase. And again, we're going to see the importance of this enzyme shortly. And characteristically, these things have lactoferrin and a B12 binding protein, which is what is used to identify them as a specific or a secondary granule. The other phagocytic cell is the macrophage. Again, morphologically, you know from your histology that you can identify this cell. It is a mononuclear cell, but it's got this characteristic kidney-shaped nucleus. These are a little bit harder to identify, obviously, than the PMNs, and I'm sure you know if you've looked at all these cells. These cells don't contain specific granules, but they do contain numerous lysosomes that have some of these same characteristics of those granules that are found in the neutrophils. The marker that's used to identify these is this marker CD14. So this is an antigen on the surface of these cells, and we can use antibodies to detect that. So CD14 becomes the characteristic marker of macrophages. Okay, so what do these cells do, these phagocytic cells do? They respond to what are referred to as SOS signals. And there's a number of different SOS signals. One of them is N-formyl methionine-containing peptides. They have receptors on their surface for N-formyl methionine-containing peptides. So what does that have to do with protection? Well, it turns out that all bacteria start all their proteins with N-formyl methionine. So that when they make a protein, the first amino acid is N-formyl methionine. Now, when they make that protein, very often they clip off a part of the N-terminal end of that protein. And so they release these N-formyl methionine-containing peptides. And so these cells have a receptor for those peptides. And when that receptor encounters that ligand, that is a signal then that there has been an infection. There's a bacterial infection going on because N-formyl methionine peptides are being contained. But this is not the only SOS signal. There are components of the clotting system that can be recognized by these cells and alert these cells that an infection is going on or that the skin barrier has been compromised. We're going to see that many of the components of complement actually also participate. There are receptors on the cells for complement components, and this is a signal that there's complement has been activated, something's going on, this is a warning signal. And then various cytokines released by tissue macrophages or by other cells will actually activate these or alert these cells that an infection is going on. And they respond in the following way. The first thing they do, macrophages and PMNs in the circulation will adhere to the endothelial cells. And the reason that they adhere is that these same signals actually also alter the endothelial cell to express new cell adhesion molecules. And these cell adhesion molecules then allow the phagocytic cells to bind to the endothelium in the area, in the vicinity of this, wherever their infection is going on. Then these cells, of course, will diapedes and move across the endothelial cell barrier and get into the tissue spaces where they are attracted to these signals in a chemotactic manner. So they migrate towards an increasing concentration gradient of these signals. And then again, many of these things, many of these components also activate these cells. And by when we talk about activation of a cell, what we simply mean is that this cell takes on properties where it is functionally better. So, if, for example, if these cells can phagocytize a particle after activation, they'll do it better. In addition, activation can also mean the acquiring of a new function that they didn't have prior to that. So activation is used to refer to either of those situations, requiring doing something better or acquiring a new function. And then what they do is they eat the whatever particles are there at the site of the infection, and they kill them. Okay? So what initiates this phagocytic process? Well, what initiates it is the binding of the bacterium to one of a variety of receptors that these phagocytic cells have. And there are a number of them. These cells have a receptor, which is called an Fc receptor for IgG. We'll see why it's called an Fc receptor later, but it's an Fc receptor for IgG. And if a particle is coated with immunoglobulin G or IgG, then that will bind to this receptor and initiate the phagocytic process. But that is not the only receptor these have. They have receptors for various components of complement. We're going to see that when we talk about the complement, that some of these components, these phagocytic cells have receptors for these components. So we have here a bacterium that has activated complement and binding to a complement receptor. That will also initiate phagocytosis. There are other receptors. There's a receptor called the scavenger receptor. Scavenger receptor is a receptor that recognizes a lot of different polyanionic molecules. So they have to be polyanions to bind to that receptor. And macrophages and PMNs have this receptor. Bacteria have a lot of polyanionic molecules on their surface. They can bind to They can bind to that receptor, initiate the phagocytosis process. And then finally, there are a whole group of receptors that are referred to as toll-like receptors. And these receptors recognize certain components of the bacterium. And when they then bind to that receptor, then that can initiate phagocytosis. So by any one or all of these things occurring, the phagocytosis is initiated. And in phagocytosis, the phagocytic cell, after binding, then extends pseudopods around the particle. And then eventually it will be sealed off, and we end up with what is referred to as a phagosome. And then these granules, in the case of the PMNs, or the lysosomes in the case of the macrophages, begin to fuse with the phagosome to form what is referred to as a phagolysosome. And then they release all their contents into these vesicles by which they're going to kill these bacterial cells. Now, what happens, of course, many times, as this process is going on, these granules actually start fusing with the phagosome prior to the actual completely closing off of pinching off of the phagosome here. And so consequently, a lot of times, these things will be released, the contents of these granules or lysosomes can be released into the tissue spaces, and that's why there's collateral tissue damage going on, because some of these toxic products actually get out of the cell if these granules start fusing prior to the full formation of the phagosome, and they certainly do that. Okay, so how do they kill? There are a number of ways that these cells kill the bacterial cells. And one of the things that's observed is that when this process of phagocytosis is initiated and you start forming this phagosome, There is simultaneously with that, there is an increase in oxygen consumption and the utilization of glucose. And this is referred to as the respiratory burst. So you have this increase in oxygen consumption and glucose is utilized in the process. And there are a series of reactions that occur within this phagolysosome then that result in the production of a lot of reactive oxygen species. And so here are the reactions. With glucose and NADP, with the enzyme glucose, the 6-phosphate dehydrogenase, to form pentose phosphate in NADPH. If you'll remember back from your biochemistry, that's the first step of the hexose monophosphate shunt. Okay? So that reaction goes on. And this product, the NADP, then, with molecular oxygen and the enzyme NADPH oxidase, goes to form NADP in a substance called superoxide. Now, this enzyme, NADPH oxidase, if you remember, was one, there were at least one of the components of the granules of the neutrophils is one component of this NADPH oxidase. And what happens when those granules fuse with the phagosome, they reconstitute, the NADPH oxidase enzyme is reconstituted in the phagolysosome membrane, and we end up with an active enzyme that can carry out this process. So we get the production of this superoxide anion. Now that superoxide anion in an acidic environment and with the enzyme superoxide dismutase can be converted into peroxide and singlet oxygen. And of course these phagolysosomes are also acidified, and so there is an acidic environment there, so this reaction goes on. And then finally, some of this superoxide anion can react in a non-enzymatic way with the hydrogen peroxide to produce hydroxyl radical, hydroxide, and some more singlet oxygen. And all of these that I've indicated in red are highly reactive oxygen species, and they kill the bacteria. Right? Now, these reactions that we just described here are referred to as the oxygen-dependent myeloperoxidase-independent reactions, because obviously they're dependent on oxygen. They use oxygen, but myeloperoxidase is not involved in these reactions at all. But myeloperoxidase, remember, was in those primary granules. And so if myeloperoxidase is around, then there is other reactions that can go on. Some of the peroxide produced in the previous reactions then with some halide. Now, I'm indicating chloride here, but in fact, that can be any halide. Chloride is obviously the most common halide, but that could be any halide. And what myeloperoxidase does is myeloperoxidase catalyzes the formation of hypochlorous acid from the hydrogen peroxide and chloride ion. And of course, this is nothing else but bleach. That's what our common household bleach is. And of course, bleach is again a very high, very toxic to bacteria, and so they get killed by this hypochlorous acid. Then some of the hypochlorous acid actually can also go and generate some more singlet oxygen in a non-enzymatic reaction. So these are then the oxygen-dependent myeloperoxidase-independent reactions. I'm sorry, myeloperoxidase-dependent reactions. Now, these are probably the most important, the oxygen-dependent reactions are probably the most important in killing bacteria, because these are very toxic products, okay? But there are backup systems. There are patients that have deficiencies, for example, in NADPH oxidase. If you have a deficiency of NADPH oxidase, you're not going to be able to carry out any of these reactions, because you won't be able to get the first step of the reaction going. So clearly that is a major deficiency. And in fact, these patients do suffer from more commonly get bacterial infections. I mean, they come down with a lot of bacterial infections. But they don't die. And similarly, there are myeloperoxidase deficiencies. Certain patients have deficiencies in myeloperoxidase. And while they are compromised, they are more susceptible. They don't die from these things. And the reason they don't die is because there are backup systems to these oxygen-dependent systems that are oxygen independent. Before I get to that, I forgot it. Let me just maybe stress this point. These products, these oxygen products that were being produced, are obviously highly toxic. If they get into the cell, our cells, they're going to destroy our proteins and destroy our cells too. And so obviously there's got to be a way of detoxifying these compounds so that we don't get the overproduction of them. And there are some detoxification reactions. This is the reaction that led to the production of hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide can be broken down by catalase back into water and oxygen. And so this catalase basically acts to dampen these reactions and don't let them get too far. Or if any of these compounds get into the cell, they will be destroyed by the reactive oxygen species can be destroyed by catalase. Okay, so let's go on to this oxygen independent. I was making the point that there are backup systems. And all these other components that are found in these granules or in these lysozymes actually participate in what is referred to as the oxygen-independent killing mechanism. Things like the cationic proteins, they damage the bacterial membrane. Lysozyme breaks down that cell wall of the bacteria. Lactoferrin, competing for iron, depriving the bacterium of iron. And there are a series of proteolytic enzymes there that can actually digest the organism. So even in patients that have defects in one or more of the oxygen-dependent mechanisms of killing, which are very important, they don't die because we have these backup systems. They are more susceptible, however, to infection. So this just sort of summarizes the way that the killing. We have the oxygen-dependent and oxygen-independent mechanisms of killing. And then we break the oxygen dependent down to the myeloperoxidase dependent and independent reaction. Okay, now in the case of macrophages have another way of killing that PMNs don't. And that is using nitric oxide. When a macrophage encounters a bacterium, and bind to one of these SOS receptors, not only does it phagocytose that particle, but in addition, it's activated to produce the cytokine TNF, tumor necrosis factor, TNF-alpha. And that TNF-alpha that is produced by the macrophage can act in an autocrine fashion or in a paracrine fashion. Do you know what the autocrine and paracrine mean? Okay, so so we can act in an autocrine fashion or in a paracrine fashion and stimulate this cell or activate the cell then to produce nitric oxide, which is a reactive nitrogen species. And that can kill the bacteria. And nitric oxide is one of the mechanisms that macrophages use to kill other cells as well. Now, if these macrophages also encounter another cytokine, interferon gamma. And interferon gamma is produced actually by T cells. And so this is one of the ways that there's an interplay between the system. The T cell being a component of the specific immune system produces interferon gamma, which can bind to the macrophages and further activate the macrophages to even produce more. You get a huge increase in the amount of nitric oxide produced. Now, this nitric oxide that's being produced by these cells is not the same nitric oxide. The chemical is the same, but the nitric oxide that you've probably heard about in physiology is produced by a different enzyme. It's produced by, this is referred to as an inducible nitric oxide synthase, or NINOS. So this is produced by a completely different enzyme. And this nitric oxide then can not only kill these bacterial cells, but they also, as I said, macrophages can use this to kill other cells as well because they release that nitric oxide. Yes? No. To septic shock? No, because this is occurring, you know, in this local area. I mean, this is not going to be a systemic reaction. So the nitric oxide, we're releasing it right at the site of the infection, okay? So this is not going to contribute to septic shock. Septic shock is going to be primarily due to components of the bacteria that are going to release and get around systemically. Something like the lipopolysaccharide from gram-negative bacteria will induce septic shock. Okay. Okay. Now, in the next group of cells are referred to as non-specific killer cells. These are there's a group of cells that what they do is they kill foreign or altered self targets, and these include things like the NK cell and our and the derivative the cell that's derived from that, the LAC cells. A cell that's called a K cell, and in the K cell is actually any cell that can mediate this process called ADCC. And what ADCC stands for is antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity. So this is going to be toxicity that's dependent upon antibodies. We're going to use antibodies. So any cell that can carry out ADCC is referred to as a K cell. Activated macrophages fall into this class because, I said, remember, macrophages can kill other cells. And eosinophils are in this group. So let's look at some of those cells. The natural killer cells, NK cells. These are also known as LGLs or large granular lymphocytes. And because if you look at them morphologically, they are mononuclear cells. They're a little bit larger than a typical resting lymphocyte. They have a little bit more cytoplasm. And if you look at the cytoplasm, I mean, it's not very clear in this picture, but if you look at them, they have a number of granules where typically you don't see granules in a lymphocyte. So that's why they're called large granular lymphocytes. And these cells have the ability to kill virus-infected or malignant cells. And again, these are much more difficult to identify morphologically. So it's more common to use these cell surface markers that can be used to identify the cells. And in the case of the NK cells, what is used is CD56 and CD16. And the absence of CD3, so an NK cell is CD56, CD16 positive, CD3 negative. And the reason for making the distinction is there are some cells that are CD56, CD16 positive, as well as CD3 positive. But those, in fact, are T cells. All right, they're not NK cells. So it has to be CD56 positive, CD16 positive, CD3 negative. And when these cells are activated by interleukin-2 or interferon gamma, they convert then into the LAC cells. And so here we have an NK cell. Upon exposure then to either interferon or IL-2, these cells will become activated, and they will then do a better job of killing cells, and then they will kill malignant cells. If they continue to be exposed to the cytokines interleukin and interferon gamma, they actually transform again to a more active cell, which not only kills malignant cells, but also can now kill just a transformed cell, a pre-malignant cell. So there's a lot of interest in these cells. And in fact, one of the therapies that is used is to take a patient that, in the case of treating of certain cancers, is to take a patient's cells, take the blood, get the NK cells from them, activate them with IL-2 or interferon gamma, and then inject them back in the patient. Because what you've done is you've activated them in vitro and then administer them back to the patients, and then they do a better job of destroying the tumors. So that's one of the therapies. It's called LAC cell therapy. Now, if you think about it, there's a potential problem here, because an NK cell and a LAC cell, they're recognizing a self cell, right? And they're killing it, right? I mean, if it's a malignant cell, they're recognizing one of our cells, and they're killing it. So there's got to be a way that the cell ensures that it doesn't kill any old cell of ours, because it could theoretically then could kill any of our cells. So how does the NK cell or the LAC cell distinguish between a normal cell and either a virus-infected or a transformed cell? And the way they do that is the following. They actually have two receptors on their surface. There's a receptor called KAR. This stands for killer activating receptor. So this is a receptor which, when it encounters its ligand, the killer activating ligand, is going to result in killing. But they also have on their surface another receptor called the KIR, killer inhibitory receptor. And its ligand is a molecule called MHC class 1, a class 1 MHC antigen. We're going to be talking a lot about the structure of these things because these are involved in the specific immune system. But for the time being, just say that this is a molecule that is found on all nucleated cells. It's a class 1 MHC molecule. It's found on all nucleated cells. So what happens in... Why doesn't the NK cell kill a normal cell? Well, what happens is, yes, the NK cell, the killer activating receptor, is engaged with its ligand. But in addition, the killer inhibitory receptor encounters its ligand, this class 1 MHC molecule. And the inhibitory signal then blocks, the inhibitory receptor blocks the signal of the activating receptor, and we don't kill this target, this cell. But what happens when a cell gets virus infected, or when a cell transforms and becomes malignant, what happens is that this class 1 MHC molecule is either turned off, the production is either turned off or it's downregulated. So that in a transformed or a virus-infected cell, what happens is the killer activating receptor is activated, but there is no ligand for the killer inhibitory receptor, and this then gets activated and it kills the target cell. All right? So by taking advantage of the fact that the MHC class 1 is being downregulated in either a virus-infected or a malignant cell, we specifically kill only those malignant cells. And in fact, some viruses actually, that's what they do in their life cycle. They block for the expression of this class 1 MHC molecules. So that's why we don't kill our natural killer cells, don't go around killing our normal cells. Okay, K cells. Again, these K cells, this is more of a functional definition. It is not a distinct cell type or a unique cell type, because any cell that has certain properties can mediate this process called ADCC is considered a K cell. So morphologically, it's not a unique type of cell. Anything just that mediates that process. Now, all of these cells have a Fc receptor on their surface. So here we have a killer K cell, and it's got this Fc receptor, and it's a receptor for immunoglobulin. And whenever you have a target cell, then, that is coated with immunoglobulin, that immunoglobulin can engage into that Fc receptor, and the antibody then acts as a bridge, bringing these cells close enough so that the killer cell can actually kill the antibody-coated cell. And that's why this is referred to as antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity, because without this, the K cell will not engage with the kill target and kill the target. So this is antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity. And any cell that can carry out this process is referred to as a K cell. And they include things like NK cells. NK cells are actually also K cells. They can kill by this mechanism as well. Macrophages. Macrophages have this Fc receptor. Eosinophils can do this. They have a receptor, but not for IgG, but for another immunoglobulin, an IgE. And there are other cells that have Fc receptors. So any cell that has an Fc receptor that can carry out this process of ADCC is considered a K cell. So it is not a distinct, unique cell type. Okay. Any questions?